Welcome to the quick start tutorial to Zabarius Chapter 1, The Origin, from eMobility Now and Hero Time, a game by Moish Glick and Benny Goldstein. Zabarius plays 2-4 players in a free-for-all or team game for ages 8 to 99 and plays between 20 to 40 minutes depending on the number of players. The magical realm of Zabarius flourished with peace and prosperity while under the rule of Magnus Darkenstar. Over the years, Magnus grew hungry for power beyond the natural world can provide. Consumed by his desires, Magnus left his throne for the taking, as he sets off into the vast lands of Biomoon Desert searching for ascension and has never been seen since. Now, years after having no rightful ruler over the lands of Zabarius, the great tribes who once stood united grow wary and hungry for bloodshed. The guardians, the orcs, the humans, and the undead. Each tribe seeks to conquer the whole realm. You, as the leader of your tribe, must lead your race to dominance through strategic planning, maneuvers, and accusations. You will lead your warriors into victory or oblivion. Now the fate is in your hands. Let's get started with setup. For each player, we'll choose a team. There are 4 teams to choose from with their own color. Orcs in yellow, guardians in green, undead in red, and humans in blue. Each player receives a board in their team color and places it in front of them to create the Zabarius realm. While forming, the players may choose any orientation of their board. The way the board is configured is determined by the number of players in the game. In a 2-player game, simply place both boards together, lining up the roads. For a 3-player game, the configuration looks like this, making sure the game boards have the roads lining up. In a 4-player game, the board should form a square. There are many more ways to form the boards. It's all up to your creativity. Now each player gets all their pieces of their team to place in front of them. It would be best to organize your pieces like this. 4 wood units in 3 groups in a row, 3 iron units in 3 groups in a row, and 2 gold units in 3 groups in a row. Take 3 banners of each type and place them next to and grouped to the same type of units. Each player should also receive 5 dice of their color, and all players receive 370 denarii. The money used in the game. You can use 3 gold ingots worth 100, 1 silver ingot worth 50, and 2 copper ingots with 10 to start off. Now it's time to place the first banners. Depending on the number of players in the game, place your banners on the far corner from each other. Finally, roll off to see who gets to go first. The highest begins the game. The first player begins the game. Teams take their turn and following with the next player to the left taking their turn. The game's goal can be played in one of 2 ways. Either in a bloodbath, where all players fight it out and the last player left standing wins. The other way is classic, where all players play until one of the player loses. Then all the remaining players count up all their values of their cities, and the one with the most points is declared the winner. A player is eliminated when all their units and fortresses are wiped out from the board. When a player turns begin, they will collect money from the banners from when the second round has begun. The current player looks at their banners and see how much money they will receive. For each wooden banner, the player will receive 50, 100 for silver banners, and 150 for gold banners. After receiving their money, the player can do their actions. A player may take any number as they desire, as long as they have enough resources to use for it. Actions a player can take are upgrading their fortress, training new units, moving units to a desired location, attacking, conquering a new fortress, casting a spell. Let's first talk about training new units in their fortress. A banner can train up to its level. So a wood banner can train wood units, an iron banner can train iron and wood units, and a gold banner can train all units. A banner can hold up to a number of units, so when training units, you need enough space in your fortress in order to create a new one. A fortress with a wood can hold up to one unit, a silver up to two, and a gold up to three. To train a unit, you need to pay the cost and place it in the fortress. The newly created unit may move and take its action immediately after being placed. Remember, you are allowed to create any number of units in fortresses as long as you can pay for the cost and have enough room to place the new units in. For example, you cannot train an archer on a blue wood banner if they are already a warrior on the city. Yet, if you first upgrade the wood banner to iron, then you may train the archer and place him in the city where the warrior, because the iron city can hold up to two units on its square. Each unit can move once per turn and take up to one action. A unit is allowed to either move or before they do their action. The actions include attack, conquer a fortress, or cast a spell. Note that a unit cannot move a few steps, take an action, and move a bit more. Once a unit moved and took its action, that unit turns ends for this round. Just a bit more of detail about units. Each unit are double-sided that displays different info about the unit. On the back, it gives its name, cost, and spell if it has one. On the front, it has the strength, its given base value, and number of dice it rolls, the range in which how far it can attack, and speed in which how far at most can your unit move per turn. Each team has their own set of units with their own stats and spells. Units move from square to square based on their speed listed on its front. If a unit has a speed of 5, the unit can move up to 5 squares. Movement is up and down, left and right. A unit can move diagonally only on the exception that there is a diagonal path going into the next square. And a unit may not move through enemy units, cannot move over water, and may not end their movements on friendly or your units. But your unit may move onto it as long as it's your fortress and it has enough room to fit enough units. To attack, your unit needs to be in range of the defending unit. The unit's range found in the front of the unit determines how many spaces its attack can reach in a straight line. You can also count diagonal paths as long as it's on a straight line and your attacks cannot cross water. A unit on a hill space has their range increased by 1. You may only make 1 attack per unit per turn. Just a note, you cannot attack a player who has not had a chance to play their first turn. When attacking a unit, both the player who is attacking and the player who is defending roll the number of dice shown on their unit. Add the dice rolls up together and add the units to your unit's basic strength, which is found on the top left of the unit in order to know your unit's battle outcome score. The unit with the higher battle outcome score wins, and the loser takes their unit off the board and returns it to their player area. The defending unit gets to remove the attacker if it wins, if it's in range of the attacker. If both scores are equal, then the win goes to the defender. Attacks can be coordinated to either attacking or defending. This means you can have multiple units attacking one single unit. If you want to coordinate an attack, move all your units in attacking position so they may reach the defending unit within their range. Then all the attacking units roll their dice strength. Then add up all the basic strength value of all the units you want to use in the coordination, given that they are all in range. The defender rolls its strength. If the attacker wins, the defending unit is removed from the board. If the defender wins, then all the attackers lose. Remove any attacker that is in range of the defending unit. If you're coordinating a defense, you must make sure that all your friendly defending units can reach the attacking unit within their range. Then, when being attacked, you will roll only the dice of the main attack target, and then you will add up all the basic strength of your friendly defending units as well as your main targeted unit basic strength. Add the dice roll to the total basic strength, and that is your battle outcome score. Remember, if it's a draw, the defending player wins. Also note that on each board is a space, center of power, and as long as a player has any of their units on this space, there will be provided an extra 2 basic strength to all your friendly units. That way, in the future, if you're being attacked or you are the attacker, you will gain a +2 basic strength for all your units individually and increases your chances of winning. This is very useful in large coordinated attacks or defense. there is one mountain on top of each board. If during the game a range unit with 2 range or higher stands on it, the specific unit standing there will gain a bonus of +1 to its range. If you have a unit on an empty fortress, you can place a wood banner for free, but it will cost your unit an action. If an enemy's banner is on the fortress, then another player can conquer it by going into the banner and using an action to take over it, replacing the banner with your banners, and always starting with the wood banner. Return the enemy's banner to its owner. Note that the unit can only use one action, so if a unit attacks, wins the battle, and then moves onto the fortress, it cannot take over a fortress since it has taken up its action. With wooden banners, a player may only train wood level units. In order to train better and stronger units, you need to upgrade your fortress. On your turn, you can upgrade any of your fortresses to the next level. To upgrade to a wooden banner to an iron banner, pay 100 denarii, and from an iron banner to a gold banner, pay 150 denarii. Remember, the game will end once one player has conquered and takes out all their enemy units and fortresses. If you wish to play a shorter game, you may play the classic version or simply stop the game at any time or stop when the first player is out of the game. Complete the round and the game will end. The player with the most valued fortresses wins. If that's a tie, the player with the most valued units wins the game. Take in mind, even though there are endless strategies and dozens of ways to play the game, this game is really easy to learn, so it makes a great gateway game. And having so many options to how to end a game really makes the replayability fantastic. So take your time to learn the different skills and the races, practicing and becoming a true champion of Zabarius. This concludes Zabarius Chapter 1, The Origin. For more information about this game, please check out emobilitynow.com. The Garbage Stacker likes to thank Emobility Now for sponsoring this video. Thanks for watching our video. For more board game videos like this, including reviews, previews, and tutorials, please check out thegarbagestacker.com and subscribe to our YouTube channel. I'm Ferdinand the Garbage Stacker, reminding you to keep on stacking games.